here. And there used to be a ballpark where the field was warm and green, and the people played their crazy game with a joy I'd never seen. And the fans, they'd watch and wonder how they laughed and how they'd cheer. Yes, there used to be a ballpark right here. A haunting lyric expressing a sense of loss and sadness at the disappearance of two well-loved and iconic New York City sports grounds, Ebbets Field in Brooklyn and the Polo Grounds. Our emotions today, as we come to the mainly forgotten site of the first Celtic Park, are those of pride, celebration and commemoration. It is a place built by supporters, referred to affectionately by Brother Walfred as the Old Quarters, where, as Willie Mealy said, that wonderful scheme of things came to fruition. His golden period was in the late Victorian era, when as distinguished actor and author John Kearney, a Parkhead boy from that street down there, says that the first Celts breathed a finer kind of air. Queen Victoria, Empress of India, had reigned for over half a century, and in this day in 1888, she opened the International Exhibition of Science, Art and Industry at Kelvin Grove Park. The greatest investigatory minds at Scotland Yard were baffled by the bizarre and violent murders in Whitechapel. The game was afoot for the very first time as Holmes and Watson embarked in their study in scarlet. While Glasgow Wains had no fear in a darkened close or even a pen, because Bram Stoker's Dracula hadn't taken his first bow. Entertainment greats who would find fame in the modern era, comedy legend Harpo Marx, the epitome of style Maurice Chevalier, and renowned composer Irving Berlin were born that year. Gauguin, Van Gogh, Yeats and Wilde were still enriching the arts, while in Helensburgh, John Logie Baird had made his first appearance in the world, the medium he invented, destined to become the greatest vehicle for the global popularity of the beautiful game. The first Celtic Park is a heritage site central to the Celtic narrative, and always held deep in the folk memory of the East End Celtic supporting community. The Celtic Park of today, with its soaring stands dominating the skyline, dressed now in that evocative and visually stunning pictorial collage, fronted by the impressive Celtic Way, is indeed a paradise. But the modest ground behind us here in Dalmarnock Street, in the words of a music hall favourite of the time, was a little bit of heaven for those early supporters and the team. It was here that Celtic became the people's team, the birthplace of that unique, intimate and unshakable bond that exists between the Celts who watch and those who play. It was surely this which enabled the emergent Celts to succeed and to thrive, where long forgotten emeralds, shamrocks, harps and errands had failed. More than a century before the phrase was coined, Celtic were more than a club, committed from the very, very beginning to equality, to tolerance, social justice and charity, completely shunning sectarianism and any form of bigotry. A 128-year-old charitable dimension began right here, continued today by the Celtic Foundation, that works tirelessly and with boundless generosity to aid those in the most need. A close and unique affinity with the supporters was developed here, which continues to this day. For example, with what other team would legendary manager Jock Steen stand at Ridley Lights flagging down supporters' coaches to intimate a late cancellation at Dundee? Or the wonderful Tommy Burns have broken away from Cup final celebrations to go on national television to tell a wee lad in hospital that he would visit him the next day. Or where a star player, Georgios Samaras, and superfan Jay Beattie would embark upon their own very unique and personal kind of lap of honour. The early years in this tiny ground were exhilarating, an enthusiastic, driven and professional committee almost immediately established Celtic as one of Britain's top clubs. One historian tells us that in their progress towards the very top, nothing seemed to daunt their enthusiasm or stay their enterprise. The tramp of feet had not yet been heard in Janefield Street, but the supporters were flocking in thousands to the new Celtic Park. It was hosting cycling and athletic events. It staged prestigious friendlies against the great English sides, Everton, Blackburn, Burnley and Preston North End. Top amateur side Corinthians were here, as well as Notts County, the world's oldest football club. They were all welcomed to Celtic Park. And indeed, it had some notable firsts. The team's first competitive victory over Rangers in the Scottish Cup of 1890. The first ever Scottish League match. And perhaps the first recorded incidence of psyching out of opponents so prevalent in the modern game. Even more effective than the Bruni or Scott's steely stare. They completely unnerved opponents, Queen's Park, by a simple, brilliant Celtic tactic. They locked them out the park. I don't care what anybody says, we should use that in Europe. Goal nets were first used on New Year's Day 1892, amid fears, by the way, among the medical profession that they may have had an adverse psychological effect in custodians who, as Handley in his history says, may have been bound in by saucy doubts and fears. On that day, there was a show business element. Colonel Burke of Buffalo Bill's Wild West Show, a VIP guest of the day, was invited to kick off. He should have brought Sitting Bull with him, as the result was an even greater disaster in the Little Bighorn. Unfortunate goalkeeper Tom Duff, his judgment impaired by illness and the fact that he'd had a slight refreshment the night before, conceded 8 goals to Dumbarton. He never played again. The old stadium's last hurrah was a glorious one on the 1st of June 1892. Rangers were defeated 2-0 in the Charity Cup final, the Celts securing the first cup treble in the history of the Scottish game, prompting one supporter, Ned McGinn, to send a telegram to the Pontiff, Leo XIII. Holiness, we've won 3 cups. But appropriately, the last kick of the ball in the old park here was for charity, a friendly, providing funds for the Irish Evicted Tenants Fund. And then, like Walfred, that year, it was gone. It was here that players experienced the thrill of pulling on the famed green and white colours of the club, and experienced the pride and the exhilaration of being a Celt, of receiving the adulation of an adoring crowd, of knowing that it was indeed a grand old team to play for. And the players were all grand. A galaxy of stars played here and made the Celtic the best darn team in Scotland, playing football that thrilled and entertained. James Kelly, the club's first captain and internationalist, future chairman, and perhaps the first player ever to celebrate a goal with a triple somersault. Willie Maley, 50 years a Celt, an incomparable manager, the man who built the Celtic. Handsome Tom, his brother, with matinee idol, good looks. Neely McCallum, the shadow, Celtic's first goal scorer. Goal machine, Sandy McMahon, the Duke, tearing defences apart with his pace and with his power. Double winner on both sides of the border, Johnny Campbell. McLaren, the old general, a hero against England, scoring a winning goal at the Oval. The first superstar Celt, Willie Groves. And Gerry Reynolds, the man with the iron head, who long before a famous US TV talk show was greeted with chants of Jerry, Jerry. The master of back heels, flicks, feints and swerves, Johnny Madden. And of course, the Wild Rover, Dan Doyle, who in his deathbed said that at least his old legs had made a little bit of Celtic history. Contemporary pundits hailed them as they developed a distinctive and trophy-winning style of play. They were fast, they were clever, they were irrepressible. They played pure, unadulterated soccer. They were hailed as perfect exponents of the game, into which, by the way, they breathed new life. But this Victorian band of brothers had an added advantage that no one else could claim. They were imbued with the spirit of Brother Walfred. They were driven by the dynamic leadership of John Glass. They were inspired.